Good morning, Rockridge Church. Thank you so much for joining us on another beautiful Sunday morning. Before we get into our worship of God and study of His Word, I have a lot of invitations to make to you guys. If you've been tuning in, you'll recognize some of them. But go ahead and take out your calendars, open it up to February. First invitation is just for the ladies. On February 23rd, that's a Wednesday, our Women's Bible Study returns. It begins here at the property. Feel free to check out our website at rockridgechurch.org or find us on social media on Facebook or Instagram for all the details and to find links to buy the study guide that you'll be using in that women's study. Moving forward into March, Saturday, March 5th, we have a men's breakfast here on the property at 8:30 a.m. I promise it'll be some of the best breakfast burritos you've ever had, and don't let this scare you away, but I'll be doing a little bit of Bible teaching there too. 6 days later, on Friday, March 11th, we're doing a movie night here in the church. Feel free to learn more about the feature we'll be showing called American Gospel at AmericanGospelFilm.com. Basically, it's a documentary about, well, why we should believe and preach and study this, the Word of God. 3 days after that, we have a men's Bible study that starts here at the property at 6:30 p.m., and we'll be using some curriculum developed by the same guys who make the American Gospel film. So if you'd like to get a feel for who these guys are and what the curriculum is going to be about, feel free to join us for that movie night too. And finally, on Saturday, March 26th, we're doing a Kids Day Out that's going to include a visit to Uptown Jungle Fun Park. That's a big trampoline park here in town. Some musical worship here at the church. And of course, it'll finish off with every kid's favorite thing, some ice cream. Cost for that is $25. And again, feel free to find the details at our website. All right. With all that said, time for us to pick up our Bibles now. We're going to open up to the book of Ephesians, chapter 2. Oh, I know we're in Galatians, but we've been beginning every single one of these sermons by reading Ephesians, chapter 2, verses 1 to 13, because it's here that we find the gospel, the good news, preach to the Gentiles that Paul's defending in the book of Galatians. So let's dive into this together once more at Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1. And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which He loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with Him, and seated us with Him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages He might show the immeasurable riches of His grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Therefore, remember that at one time you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision, by what is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands, remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. Let's pray together. Lord, this gospel declares that by your grace, you have given us life. You have rescued us from death and made us alive with you. Thank you, Lord, for taking the initiative to save us, for not leaving us to our own devices, which would have only led to death. Thank you that we are your workmanship and not our own handiwork, that you work on us, that you make us what we are, new creations with new life and a new identity. Lord, if we ever boast in anything, it should only ever be about your cross. God, you've done your will in us. And we cheer on the arrival of the fullness of your kingdom and beg you to accomplish your will with the rest of this world. Because we want to see your second coming, Lord. We want to experience the full riches of your kindness toward us. The new world, the new Jerusalem, the rivers of living water, the place where all things are made new. Lord Jesus, we ask that you bring that to us in your own good time. In your glorious name, amen. I'm really grateful to be here with you this morning and to share my faith with you. And in the core of that faith belongs my conviction that you and I, that we are the beloved daughters and sons of God. Those are the opening words of a sermon that I don't know how many times I've watched it, but it has never stopped being precious to me. This is a sermon that's very dear to my heart. It was preached by a Roman Catholic priest named Henry Nouwen at the Crystal Cathedral, if you remember that, for the Hour of Power in 1993. Nouwen also said in that sermon that one of the hardest jobs that we have as Christians is just to remember who we are, to remember that we are always God's beloved children, to claim that as our identity, and then to go and live our lives based on that knowledge. He said this is so hard to do that most of us fail constantly to claim that truth about ourselves, that we are indeed the beloved daughters and sons of God. Now, that sermon might have been preached in Orange County in the 20th century, but as we saw last week in Galatians chapter 3, this is not a unique feature of modern Western American Christian life. This identity crisis is actually a really old problem. What Nouwen said in 1993 has maybe always been true for Christians. We can see the Galatians struggling with it. They heard the gospel from Paul and they believed it, but it only took one group coming in from Jerusalem, preaching a false message, to have these churches in Galatia nearly convinced that they were never actually welcomed into the people of God, that they were never in Christ, that they were all still outsiders, still unclean, still sinners, still divided by Jew and Gentile. The circumcision party came and said that they wouldn't belong to God until they all became Abraham's children. And the only way to do that was to do the work that Abraham did and get circumcised. But Paul showed the Galatians, by going into the Old Testament scriptures, that this was a total misread of Abraham's story. Works were never the basis for God's relationship with Abraham. God counted Abraham as righteous, not because of the circumcision in his flesh, but because of his faith. Before circumcision was ever mentioned, Abraham heard God's promises and believed God's promises. Abraham trusted God. No matter how big these promises were or how impossible they might have sounded. And one of those promises is the promise of universal blessing for the whole world that was delivered in Genesis chapter 12. Paul says that's actually the gospel about Jesus being preached in advance. It was right where we ended our study last week, at verse 14 of Galatians 3, that Paul showed these Galatian churches that Jesus really is the object of Abraham's faith, and he's the fulfillment of all those ancient promises that God the Father made to him. The circumcision party said that you get into the family of Abraham by works of the law. Paul says no. No, no, no. The Old Testament scriptures themselves say that it's by faith in the promise, not works of the law. And that's the discussion that we're getting into now as we get to verse 15. Paul showing the Galatians that God's promises to Abraham are what get us into God's people, not the Torah, and giving us all kinds of reasons why we should love and trust the promise instead of the law. And we'll get to that as we pick it up at Galatians 3:15. To give a human example, brothers, even with a man-made covenant, no one annuls it or adds to it once it has been ratified. So we'll pause there first. This is what you call an argument from lesser to greater. Paul's saying that even when we, fallen, fleshly, sinful people, have a covenant between each other, you know, like a contract or a last will and testament, something solid and secure. Once that contract is made, once that covenant is made, it can't be changed or canceled. And if that's true among us sinful people, with all of our lying and our deceitfulness, well, then it certainly must be true when God makes a covenant with somebody. Now, the context here, verse 15, makes it pretty obvious that Paul's talking about God's covenant with Abraham. He started talking about God's promises to Abraham back in Galatians 3:8. And we remembered that in Genesis 12 and Genesis 15, God had made these promises to Abraham, which he would never go back on. Well, God went even further than just speaking those out as promises. There's actually a moment in Genesis 15 where God makes them a formal, official covenant. You might remember at Genesis 15, that's when God told Abraham to go outside and number the stars. And he said, "So shall your offspring be. Yes, even you, almost 100-year-old Abraham." It's in Genesis 15:6 that Abraham heard that promise and believed God to deliver on it, and that was counted to him as righteousness. We'll go even further down in that chapter. When you go down to verse 12, you'll see that Abraham falls into a deep sleep, and God speaks to him again, making even more promises, looking forward to the Exodus. And then you get down to verse 17. When the sun had gone down and it was dark, behold, a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch passed between these pieces. On that day, Yahweh made a covenant with Abraham. Now, if you've ever read those verses and wondered what the significance of that moment is, if you've ever asked yourself why Abraham had to cut a bull and a calf and a goat and these other animals in half, and then why a torch and a fire pot passed through them, well, here it is. In the ancient Near Eastern world in which Abraham lived, this was how you made a covenant official. So be thankful that you live in the world of e-signatures and DocuSign, where you can just click a few boxes and you can make your contracts good and legal. Imagine how many bulls it would take just to get through a single mortgage agreement. But in that world, at that time, the custom was that you took a bull or some other animal and you cut it in two pieces. That's why it was called cutting a covenant. But you cut it in two pieces, and then you separated the pieces, and then each member of the covenant would walk between the two halves, usually carrying some kind of instrument like a torch or a fire pot, as we see here, sometimes even a sword. And when you pass through the animal, that was like putting your signature on the contract. Everything was official now. So when God carries the torch and the fire pot through the two sections of those animals in Genesis 15, what God's doing there is making all of his promises to Abraham from Genesis 12 onward. He's making them legally binding. He's kind of putting his signature on them. He's putting his seal on them. He's signing himself to them. And there's a really fine detail in this moment too, because you'll notice that it's only God who passes through the two parts of the animal. He waits until Abraham's asleep, and then he does this. Normally, it's all the members of the covenant who have to pass through them, but here, only one does. Only God does. Abraham stays asleep. That means that God himself is the only one legally bound to fulfill these promises, to make good on this covenant. That means God put all the obligation on himself to make this covenant happen. That means from the very beginning, the free grace of God, on the initiative of God, at the will of God, to the good pleasure of God, by the handiwork of God has been part of the promise. When God made his promises to Abraham into an official covenant, it was all built on him effectively saying, I will do this. I will bring the universal blessing to the world. I will deliver on this promised offspring. So when Paul refers to a covenant in verse 15 back here in Galatians 3, it's this covenant between God and Abraham that he's talking about. What he's saying is that if even humans don't break covenants between one another, well, then surely God would never go back on a covenant that he himself formalized. He is never going to break these promises of universal blessing or offspring like the stars of the sky and the sands of the shores. Those promises are never going to be altered, and they're never going to be canceled. In fact, Paul continues, and he says that you can see from the scriptures themselves that God is actually already making good on this covenant. We'll go to verse 16. Now the promises were made to Abraham and to his offspring. It does not say, and to offsprings, referring to many, but referring to one, and to your offspring, who is Christ. So the covenant promises to Abraham were always intended to be fulfilled, not by him alone, but by the children who would come from his line. Well, as Paul points out here, not children, plural, but actually only one child, one seed. Abraham would not be a great nation, and all the world would not be blessed through him, through his many sons and grandsons and granddaughters or anything else, but just by a single son. Now, that son has to be Jesus Messiah. As Matthew 1:1 reminds us, Jesus really is a true son of Abraham and a son of David. There's no one else born into Abraham's line who's capable of fulfilling these great promises that God made to Abraham. Isaac, as great as he was, did not fulfill them. Jacob, as great as he was, actually died outside the land promised to Abraham. So it must not have been him. The 12 tribes of Israel that came from Jacob were exiled and put into chains over and over and over again. So they must not have been the fulfillment. The biblical history of Israel tells you this is not a people trying to become a blessing to the world. There are people struggling to stay in the promised land and struggling to live under the old Torah covenant. There are people waiting for the new covenant to come, promised by the prophets. But you see, when Jesus comes, he gives the whole world the gospel. The message that God has come to bless the entire world, the same message Abraham had heard centuries before. It is in the Great Commission that Jesus makes it clear that this good news is intended to travel far beyond the boundary lines of the Promised Land, far beyond the nation of Israel. This is the blessing meant for all the families of the world. That's what God said in Genesis 12. Abraham, through you, I will bless all of the families on earth. It's no coincidence that in Matthew chapter 28, verse 19, Jesus tells his disciples, take this good news and make disciples in all nations. What this means for the Galatians is that the blessing of Abraham has come to them through the fulfillment of the promise, not demanding works of the Torah. And Jesus himself is the fulfillment of these promises. That's the really important point that Paul has just made here, that Jesus is the delivery of God's covenant with Abraham. He is how God makes good on those promises. He is the promised offspring who inherits the world. Remember what the two questions are that Paul deals with here in Galatians. What God requires for our justification, for us to have right relationship with him, and how we get into the people of God who belongs to him. The circumcision party had their vision. They said it was all through obeying the Torah. You had to have Moses and Jesus, circumcision and faith. Paul says no. No, no, no. The answer to those questions comes by the promise fulfilled in Jesus. Paul says this is true because the promise has priority over the Torah. It is above the Torah, has authority over it. That's what he's saying as he continues on at verse 17. This is what I mean. The law, which came 430 years afterward, does not annul a covenant previously ratified by God so as to make the promise void. For if inheritance comes by the law, it no longer comes by the promise. But God gave it to Abraham by a promise. Now we see why Paul took so much time to explain the covenant to the Galatians. The circumcision party was going around Galatia saying that we have to be justified by our obedience to the Torah, that having faith in the gospel alone is not enough, because the law amends the promises given to Abraham, adds to them, defines them. Paul says, no, 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 that can't be possible. God would not annul or amend a covenant 430 years after he ratifies it. He's just shown everybody right there why the circumcision party can't possibly be right. We begin with the covenant. We begin with the promise. It cannot be broken. The covenant itself points forward to Jesus. The covenant promises that the blessing of Abraham would be one for all nations, Jews and Gentiles both. So if the circumcision party guys are right, well, that means something terrible has actually happened, because that would mean that God must have changed his mind, that he was unfaithful to do for Abraham what he promised. He went back on his word and he changed the covenant after it had been sealed. And that can't be true, because once that covenant was ratified, it was unbreakable. So for God to remain true to his word, which we know he always will, well, then the inheritance, that is the blessing, that is our justification, that is our union with the Holy Spirit, that is our new status as God's people, all of that can only come from this ancient covenant promise. It can never come to us from the law. So Paul sums all this up into just a couple of lines in his letter to the Romans, where he's having a pretty similar discussion. So listen to how he puts it in Romans chapter 4 at verse 13. For the promise to Abraham and his offspring that he would be the heir of the world did not come through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. For if it is the adherents of the law who are to be heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. So you have the circumcision party guys running around saying that the promise of eternal life, all of these great things that the gospel announces, well, they actually come through the law. And then you have Paul pointing out to them that that's not even what the law was designed to do. That's not why it was given. The purpose of the law was never that it would bring the blessings God promised to Abraham into the world. After all, how could it? The Torah was only given to one nation in one corner of the earth. It was not meant to build a worldwide people who would bless every family in the world. Jesus is. Jesus is given as the ransom for the human sin of all the world, not just one people. His gospel is sent to every corner of the world, not just one region, and the Holy Spirit of God is delivered and has union with anyone who believes that. That's why the promise has priority over the law. The promise came hundreds of years before the law, and God meant for it to exist after the law. The Torah system was temporary. The promise is permanent. The reason the circumcision guys kept pushing Torah obedience was that they didn't really understand the Torah. They didn't seem to understand that it had a limited scope and a limited time, and now that's done. They looked at the law and they thought that this was meant to last forever, that this would always and forever be the boundary marker for who is and who isn't a person of God. This would always and forever be how someone gets into God and is blessed by God. They thought even when the gospel came, well, Torah and gospel, they must coexist. It's only when you have them together that faith would give life. They thought the law secured the promises to Abraham. But that's all wrong. Paul knew this Torah better than anybody. And now he explains the law back to the legalists. We'll pick it up at verse 19. Why then the law? It was added because of transgressions. Maybe you've read that verse before and wondered what that means. What Paul means here is that the law was added to show Israel that their sinful behavior, it was no small thing. It was actually against God's moral standards. When God brought his people out of Egypt, he called them to be his chosen nation. But they were a sinful people, like every other people. So he gave them the Torah. So they heard the law, and they learned what God expected from them. They saw that the Torah declared that all of their sinful behaviors that they had become so accustomed to were now, for the first time, actually transgressions against these newly delivered laws of God. As Paul says in Romans 7:7, yet if it had not been for the law, I would not have known sin. For I would not have known what it is to covet if the law had said, you shall not covet. So the law has a revelatory purpose. It reveals God's perfect moral nature, and it reveals what he expects from Israel if they're going to be his people. It showed Israel their sins and made them into transgressions. But it was not put in place to last forever. Let's read some more of verse 19. Until the offspring should come to whom the promise had been made. So Jesus is the offspring who secures the covenant promises given to Abraham. The Torah was never meant to accomplish that, and it was never meant to be in place forever. It was only in force until the promise could be delivered. That means it had a limited jurisdiction. That means it had a temporary reign, and that reign ends with the arrival of the Messiah. The Torah revealed the depth of human sin so that Jesus could show the greatness of God's mercy and God's love and the consequence of his curse by going to the cross and redeeming us from that sin. Jesus fulfills the Torah. He himself said, I've come to fulfill the law and prophets. And by fulfilling it, he brings the time of its authority to an end. As Paul continues, he'll make one more point for the promise in verse 19. And the law was put in place through angels by an intermediary. Now, an intermediary implies more than one, but God is one. So what he's saying there is that Israel actually received the law third hand. It started with God, then it was given to angels, and then the angels delivered it to Moses, and then Moses became the intermediary, like the facilitator of the Torah for the nation. But the promise, well, it didn't have to go through all those filters. The promise was delivered firsthand. There was only one degree of separation from God straight to Abraham. Everything we've read here today so far is Paul showing the Galatians why they should believe the gospel of free grace and not put themselves under the Torah. He's building his case. He says the gospel is the fulfillment of the promise, and the promise is greater than the law. And Paul's shown them systematically how that's true. He says the promise came before the law. The promise is permanent. The law is temporary. The promise came directly from God. The law had intermediaries. And most of all, the promise and the law have entirely different purposes. The law exposes our transgressions, but the promise brings eternal life and brings us into Abraham's family, God's family in the Messiah. The promise saves us from the curse that the law puts us under. Now, all that might make it sound like the law and the promise are opposing forces, like the law is somehow the problem and the promise is given as the answer to that problem. That's not the setup here. That's not true. God delivered both the promise and the Torah. That means the Torah is holy. That means the promise and the covenant, they're holy too. It's sin that's the problem. The law dealt with sin for a limited time. The promise deals with sin for the whole world. From the time Jesus is crucified as the atoning sacrifice for sin until all of God's people are together in the new world. The law is not opposed to the promise. They're not enemies. But it also was not meant to be the way that we have the blessings of the promise. That was the circumcision party's big mistake here. They were declaring that, no, it's the Torah that gives us eternal life and the promise of the Holy Spirit. They were saying it does something it was never built to do. Paul touches on that again as he continues in verse 21. Is the law then contrary to the promises of God? Certainly not. For if a law had been given that could give life, then righteousness would indeed be by the law. But the scripture imprisoned everything under sin, so that the promise by faith in Jesus Christ might be given to those who believe. What the Bible reveals to us is the history of God's creation, how it started in the beginning, how it fell, and then how God redeems it. It's a certain kind of history called redemption history. Not just the story of human movements, but the story of God's movements, the stuff that God does to restore and redeem his fallen creation. The law had a place in that redemption history. And for its time, it served its purposes. But that place is gone now. That time has now passed. God had a purpose for the law, and the law did its duty. It imprisoned everything under sin, as Paul puts it, so that God's people would eagerly desire the offspring of promise. God's people had to be put under the law and under the curse, so that when Jesus came promising freedom and life, a yoke that was easy and a burden that was light, the people of God would believe him. The remnant of Israel would believe him, and they would want this blessing that he came promising. We have followed Paul's arguments really closely so far this morning, and we've taken a lot of time to unpack them carefully. I think you're ready now, as Paul continues, just to hear the themes and the ideas about redemption history and how it has moved forward into a new era. I think you're ready to hear that and what Paul's saying and understand it. So I'm just going to read the next section of this, and I want you to listen for Paul talking about Jesus fulfilling the promises to Abraham. I want you to listen for what he says about the end of the law. And I want you to listen to these two metaphors that Paul uses to talk about the movement of redemption history, the movement from an old era into a new era. So let's pick it up together at verse 23. Now, before faith came, we were held captive under the law, imprisoned until the coming faith would be revealed. So then the law was our guardian until Christ came, in order that we might be justified by faith. But now that faith has come, we're no longer under a guardian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through faith. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is no male and female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. I mean that the heir, as long as he is a child, is no different from a slave, though he is the owner of everything. But he's under guardians and managers until the date set by his father. In the same way, we also, when we were children, were enslaved to the elementary principles of the world. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father! So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. Did you catch the message of what Paul was saying there? What he was saying about the old era and the new era? The gospel says so much of what the Old Testament people were looking forward to has now finally arrived. So many promises have finally been delivered on. Paul uses this metaphor of God's people as children who have now grown up into maturity. They were heirs, but they weren't of age to receive their inheritance yet. But now we've reached, in the fullness of time, the set time appointed by our Father to receive our full inheritance. In Jesus Christ, we now have everything that was intended for us. The good news about Jesus is the good news that redemption history has advanced, that time has passed, and that the promise that the world has waited for so long to receive has finally been fulfilled. What makes this good news so good is that it declares that by faith, we have so much, that all who are in Jesus Christ have justification, that's right relationship with God, that you have union with the very Spirit of God, that you belong to the people of God, not just as far off servants, but that you've been adopted as true sons. We are in Christ, who's the true seed of Abraham, the child of ancient promises. And in him, we become heirs to this wonderful covenant promise that God made to our father Abraham thousands of years ago. To the Galatians, that means the gospel as they first heard it was true. That means the table fellowship that they were having as one unified, happy family was the vision of the new chapter in redemption history. Christ had gone to the cross to make this happen. God had sent his Holy Spirit to make this happen, all to fulfill these promises to Abraham, all accomplished in the work of Jesus Christ. Henry Nouwen's words from the beginning of our sermon witness to the truth that we've seen Paul deliver in the scriptures this morning, that you and I, we, really are the beloved sons and daughters of God. Adoption is how that happens. And yet, I know I can stand up here and go into the scriptures with you, and that even as you sit there and you hear these words read and preached about this morning, it may still be a hard thing for you to know and remember, perhaps even to believe all of this. I can tell you that in Christ, you belong to a global family. I can show you in the scriptures where it says that. But that's hard to believe when you feel alone. And I can tell you that in Christ, you're an adopted, beloved son or daughter of the Most High God. But I know that can be hard to believe when you feel very unloved. Now you know why faith is such a key word in Galatians. Faith is hearing God and believing him, and believing what he promises you, no matter how much your flesh wants to not believe it. And I know it's a stereotype for pastors to tell you that faith is the answer,
But that really is the message here in Galatians today. Paul showed the churches in Galatia all of this stuff was true. And then he called on them to believe it with faith, to go and live like all this gospel stuff is real, that everything that they heard about being new creations and a new people is real and meaningful for their lives. And for them, that meant resisting the circumcision message and believing the one true gospel. Well, the same call that's given to them here is given to us. Believe the gospel and trust what it says. Believe it no matter how badly your flesh doesn't want to believe it. Believe that no matter what sins you've committed in the past, you're not defined by them. You are covered in the covenant righteousness of Jesus Christ by faith alone. You are justified. You have right relationship with God. And it doesn't fluctuate based on how obedient you were today. Because God has grace for you and God loves you. Your relationship with God stands on the solid foundation of God's promises that came centuries before the law. That means this isn't a relationship based on works. It's a relationship based on love. Believe that when you are tempted, when you are tempted to sin, when you are tempted to transgress, you have the very Spirit of God living inside of you. The Father and the Son have sent the Spirit to you. And this Spirit gives you strength to bear fruit, gives you strength to endure. You can go to war against the passions of the flesh by the power of the Spirit. It's there for you to seize it by faith. I know you might feel sometimes unloved, maybe unwanted. I have compassion for that. The world has probably told you that before. But the gospel of Christ crucified says something else. The gospel of Christ crucified is the eternal, everlasting message of the deep and abiding, unconditional love that your Father has for you, so that you can hear that and believe that. I know you might sometimes feel lonely and feel isolated, but the gospel says that you are always surrounded by family. Wherever there are Christians around you, you have true brothers and true sisters who love you. So hear that and believe it. Call on them and let them shower you with love. Pray to God and let Him shower you with His love. It's easy to become hopeless. It's easy to live in this chaotic world and feel like you live in a world that's on fire, that is bleak and dark and has no hope for its future. But I want you to remember that you do not live simply in the middle of human history. You live in the middle of God's redemptive history. You are living through the story of God restoring His creation. And there is an end point to that story. There is a final state, a place where there is no pain anymore, nor any sickness, a place where there is no death, a place where all things are made new, a place where God is so present that there's not even a need for a star in the sky because His glory lights up the whole world as He walks the streets with His people. Hear that and believe it, no matter how much your flesh doesn't want to. So I know it's a stereotype, but it is the message from Galatians to us today, and it is one that maybe we need to hear. Have faith. Hear God and believe what He says. believe God more than you believe the world. Believe God more than you believe your flesh. Live as though what God says is true. And while you're at it, maybe take a word from our brother Henry here. And let the core of your gospel faith be the conviction that because of what Christ has done on the cross, you and I, we, are the beloved sons and daughters of God. That's who we are. Let's pray together, and then I'm going to hand it off to Chris so we can do some musical worship together. Lord Jesus, I thank you for this word. I pray that it was a convicting one. Lord, cut us to the heart so that we never forget who we are, so that we do a better job of always remembering that we belong to you, that we're loved by you, that we have this close, intimate relationship with you, where we don't just call you Lord and Master and Savior, but we actually get to call you our dearest Father. Your Spirit testifies that you're our Abba Father. That's such a beautiful thing to hold on to. So thank you, God, for giving it to us. Help us to hold on to it even more, to claim this identity and live as though it were true. To let it replace and swallow up our loneliness. To let it smash the feelings of being unloved. Thank you, Lord, for the cross. The cross which justifies us. The cross which testifies that the great God of the universe, the Most High God, dearly loves us, his people. In your glorious name, Lord Jesus, we praise you for that love today. Amen. Thank you so much for your time and attention. Let's worship together.
Stand before your Maker, full of wonder, full of fear. Come behold his power and glory, yet with confidence draw near. For the one who holds the heaven and commands the stars above is the God who bends to bless us with an unrelenting love. Rejoice, come and lift your head and raise your voice. He is worthy of our praise. Rejoice, sing of mercies of your King, and with trembling rejoice. We are children of the promise, the beloved of the Lord. One with everlasting kindness, bought with sacrificial blood. Bringing reconciliation to a world that longs to know the affections of a Father who will never let them go. Rejoice, come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of our praise. Rejoice, sing of mercies of your King, and with trembling rejoice. All our sickness, all our sorrows, Jesus carried up the hill. He has walked this path before us. He is walking with us still. Turning tragedy to triumph, turning agony to praise. There is blessing in the battle, so take heart and stand amazed. Rejoice, when you cry to him, he hears your voice. rejoice in the midst of suffering. He will help you sing. Rejoice. Come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of our praise. Rejoice. Sing of mercies of your King. And with trust.